Nobody wants a surprise in their jelly donut.
It's toothpaste?
That's because the middle is the most important part. At Graybar, we're at the middle of electrical and datacom jobs across the country, connecting installers, facility managers, and business owners with smart solutions for their most challenging projects, which means stocking and delivering crucial products on time and on budget, with no surprises, thanks to our nationwide logistics network. Yep, Graybar does that.
Instacart shoppers know groceries. They know that you can't make guacamole with rock-hard avocados. They know how to quickly find those peanut butter pretzels you can never find. And they keep you in the know by giving you updates about your order along the way. Let Instacart shoppers help take shopping off your plate so you can get time and energy back for what really matters. Visit instacart.com or download the app to get free delivery on your first three orders. Offer valid for a limited time. Minimum order $10. Additional terms apply. Instacart. Add life to cart.
Imagine the softest sheets you've ever felt. Now imagine them getting even softer over time. I'm here to tell you about Boll & Branch sheets. In a recent customer survey, 96% replied that Boll & Branch sheets get softer with every wash. They're made from the rarest organic cotton and designed to get even softer over time. Try their sheets with a 30-night guarantee plus 15% off your first order with code Odyssey. So head to bollandbranch.com today. Exclusions apply. See site for details.
It's time.
It's time.
Time to get in the zone.
Time to get in the zone.
With the 49ers Web Zone.
This is the No Huddle Podcast.
With Al and Brian.
What's up, faithful? You're listening to another episode of the 49ers Web Zone No Huddle Podcast, a part of the Odyssey Network. I am Brian Renick. He is Al Sacco. Neither one of us have missed a field goal or extra point in our life. But Jake Moody picked a really bad time for me and my anxiety to miss a field goal and extra point. A field goal and extra point that would have gotten the 49ers a victory over the Rams, which would have been two straight years of sweeping the division and just continued ownage of the Rams in the regular season. I love that Kyle Shanahan basically said it's annoying to lose to Sean McVay, tongue in cheek. He said, I know a lot of guys on that staff. It's annoying to lose to them as well. But ultimately, it's annoying to lose to anybody. But Al, how are you feeling? How are your nerves going into this playoff atmosphere, this one and done atmosphere with a rookie kicker who misses kicks in bunches, makes them in bunches, but misses them in bunches as well?
Well, Brian, before I say that, I do want to say I am depressed as shit. And maybe like I just have like some emotional problems or whatever, but there is no like sadder time for me than after the holidays and when football season ends. Yeah. I hate when the regular season ends. I know you're thinking, Al, wait a minute. The Niners are, you know, huge expectations for the Super Bowl. I'm really excited about that. I cannot wait to watch the playoffs. But when the regular season ends, it's even worse when the playoff ends. And I'll bitch about that and like, month or whatever, but when the regular season ends for me, dude, it is brutal. I hate it because I look forward to these games all week. I play fantasy, I bet on them. We have a job where we talk about football. Like, I love it, and I love fucking week eight when it's just there's a game I'm looking forward to, and I got I'm 4-3 in my fantasy, and I need a win, and there's just I got a day lined up, and my wife has already accepted that I'm lost on Sundays, and she leaves me alone, and like. I can drink beers and watch football. That's what I love it. I love every minute of it. And when it's over, it depresses the shit out of me. So that's where I am emotionally right now. Great game last night or Sunday night with the Bills and the Bills pulling that game out. But now it's over and I'm depressed. But you asked me about Jake Moody, right? Isn't that what you said? Yeah, Jake Moody.
Yes.
So yeah, you know what it is? Like one thing they knew with Robbie Gould. Yeah, he missed some kicks in the regular season. He missed some extra points, but dude was money in the playoffs. And we talked about it last show. The Niners paid a lot of money for some of these positions that aren't primary positions, and it's worked out great for them. McCaffrey, the linebackers. Juszczyk's been a big piece of the puzzle. And Robbie Gould, they paid him a lot of money, and he made kicks in the playoffs. You're going into the playoffs right now with a kicker. You have no idea how he's going to respond. And that's even if he had a good regular season, even if he's what's his name? Brandon Aubrey. Yeah, overall. Yeah. Oh, he did. I don't want to say that. But even if he didn't have spells, let's say, in the regular season, I should say, that would worry you. Even if you're that Brandon Aubrey dude from Dallas who never misses a kick, it looks like he's a robot. You don't know how he's going to respond in a 20-20 game, a 43-yard field goal. I don't even say 20-20. Say 20-18, 43-yard field goal to win it. There's huge pressure there. You have no idea how these guys are going to respond. So it's just one of those things until you see it. We don't know. And who knows if we'll even be in a position. Who knows if it matters. But if you're looking for something to worry about, yeah, I guess that's it. And I was really at the end there before Sam Darnold turned into Sam Darnold and kind of threw that fumble away or whatever the hell he did. I was really hoping that Jake Moody was going to get a chance to get the bad taste out of his mouth. Said, all right, just let's get – not that I cared about the win, but just let's get in field goal range. Let's let him get the bad taste out of his mouth, hit a game winner, and then we're not talking about anything. We're talking about he hit a big catch.
Yeah.
And now it kind of lingers. So,
yeah, I mean, that was my biggest hope after that first half, after he missed the field goal and the extra point, was that he would get at least one more opportunity in the second half to kick a field goal just to see how things went. Because it does seem like, and again, we don't have a whole lot of history, and that's the other thing. That's part of the anxiety is the uncertainty, right? Because all we have is this one season, and what we've seen in this one season is that he's pretty reliable, but when he misses, he then misses in bunches. It happened in the preseason, and then he was good in the for the first part of the regular season. And then it happened in Cleveland, and then he missed another field goal in Minnesota. I believe he missed another one against Cincinnati, right? He misses them in bunches. That's all we have to go on. And if he misses them in bunches and he missed two on Sunday, what does that portend for the next time he takes the field? Now, perhaps one of the advantages is this bye week to just kind of wash it. And, you know, maybe he goes out and he just, you know, just like free throws, just kicks 100 field goals a day. I don't know. I'm not going to pretend to know how these field goal kickers practice or anything like that. But it definitely, for me, gave me anxiety going into the playoffs that I didn't need and I didn't want more than anything. And, you know, I said something on Twitter. I tweeted out that the 49ers would be 14-3 this season if it weren't for Jake Moody misses in Cleveland and, you know, in this Rams game. Because, again, this Rams game ended 21-20. That field goal and extra point would have made it 24-21. They would have won that game. Now, obviously, there are other factors involved, right? The defense, once the starters came out and it was all second string in the second half, you know, Carson Wentz turned into Michael Vick and you know, they gave up the lead. It was 20-7. They ended up losing 21-20. The offense did nothing in the second half with Sam Darnold. I get it. But at the same time, Sam Darnold led that offense to 24 potential points, but those missed kicks only gave them 20 and they ended up losing. So, you know, is it Jake Moody's fault that they lost yesterday? No, it wasn't a situation where he could kick the game winner and they would have won like it was in Cleveland. So really you could basically, to me, you can pin one loss on Jake Moody because the offense did what they needed to do to get him down the field and he missed the kick. But it's just, like I said, it just provides anxiety. And the other thing that I don't think people think about is it provides anxiety for Kyle Shanahan, whose job is already hard enough.
Yeah.
And that was one of the things he talked about loving Robbie Gould, is that he didn't have to worry about it. If he needed to call a field goal, he's going to call a field goal. He had all the faith in the world in Robbie Gould. And you got to wonder, does he have some of that anxiety with Moody when it comes to play calling, things of that nature? It just makes his job harder because there's uncertainty there. And so they brought that upon themselves when they drafted Jake Moody in the third round. They could have gone out and got a veteran kicker. In fact, they had one in Zane Gonzalez. Like they're not without fault, but it is, like I said, going into this, that's the biggest worry I have. I don't really have worries anywhere else. There aren't injuries where I'm like, I hope that guy can come back. I think Eric Armstead will be back. You know,
knock on wood.
The offense is whole. Like, I think we're going to be fine. And honestly, I'm not even necessarily worried about it for the NFC playoffs because I don't think there's a team that can sniff the 49ers in the NFC field. But it's still there.
Yeah. And he only attempted 25 field goals this year, which is 27th in the league. Yeah. Dude kicked 61 attempts for extra points and made 60 of them, you know, until this last game. So the Niners scoring touchdowns. He actually only attempted 6 field goals over the last 7 games. So that's kind of crazy. You know,
maybe that's part of it.
Maybe he just hasn't had a lot of chances, you know, but again, it doesn't matter if you kick one field goal the whole season, if you got to kick one to go to the Super Bowl or whatever it is, you need them to do it. So it's a little bit crazy. This game though, too, like again, nobody watches more football than me. No, but I'm obsessed with football. I had a really hard time watching this game. Just felt like get this shit over with to me. Yeah. It was gross. Felt like a preseason game. Mm-hmm. It felt like just get it. I wanted to just get out of there. Like I was almost watching it through like, you know, my fingers over my eyes. Like nobody get hurt, please. Let's just get out of this. And then the second half when like no starters or anything, it was a little tough to watch. So I'm glad it's over. And I'm not glad the season's over, but I'm glad that meaningless game is over. We can get to the playoffs here and get moving in the playoffs. And Brian, the 49ers, so I was looking at a stat today. The Niners, the Packers, the Cowboys, and the Steelers all have 36 franchise postseason wins. The Patriots have 37. I just feel like it's right that the 49ers have the most postseason wins. And hopefully this season, going into this, that's what I'm thinking. All right, they're at 36. Let's get to 39. And let's once again take over with the most wins for anybody in the postseason. Because it just feels like the Niners, Steelers, Cowboys, Packers should all be up there. That feels right. The Patriots, whatever. You had a run with Brady. Go away now. I hate New England so much. But it just feels right that the Niners are back there. So that's cool. So I'm looking forward to this postseason. Like, again, that 94. And I was younger, but that 94 season, it just kind of has that feel to me. Like, I'm just ready to go out and just want them to kick everybody's ass. That's kind of what I feel like. Very confident. I'm very confident they can do that. And it's exciting to get moving here. And we'll talk a little bit about the playoff field and what the matchups could be. But I just have that huge level of excitement that I did with some of those. And again, Montana teams, I was like 10 or 11, whatever I was in those later years. But like the Steve Young teams, I'm just ready to go in there and let's just kick some ass, man. I can't wait.
Yeah, I love it. You know, although my favorite thing from the game was right at the end of the first half when they knew that they were just trying to get Puka Nacua the receiving yardage record and the catches record, and they started double teaming him to end the half. So like, we're not letting you do that. We're not letting you do that. And then eventually he got it in the second half, and they put the camera, or they showed a replay of Sean McVay on the sideline, and you could watch him watch the play develop. You watch him make the catch for the catches record, and the first thing he says is get him out. And I was like, that's perfect. I love it. But
well, you know, yeah, McVay doesn't like playing his players in those type of games,
right?
Either.
Exactly. So
that must have been killing him.
Yeah. And I do appreciate that, you know, that he had him out there to get that record, because, you know, I think some of these things are important to some of these players and players' families and things like that. And, you know, one of the things that came out of this season that I thought was interesting, I sent this in our No Huddle group chat. I said, this is an Al Sacco stat if I've ever seen one. Nick Wagner tweeted this out yesterday, but Deebo Samuel went over 1,000 rushing yards for his career on Sunday, which means that he now has 4,122 receiving yards and 1,007 rushing yards through 5 NFL seasons. He joins Hall of Famer Charlie Taylor as the only players in NFL history to hit those marks that quickly. So I thought that was really cool that Debo's in rarefied air as a, you know, as really an offensive weapon, right? Because again, when you talk about rushing and receiving, that is typically going to be a stat that involves a running back. But what Deebo Samuel isn't a running back, has never been a running back. He's just a running back a wide receiver in a running back's body. And just a cool accomplishment for him. And then the other one that I wanted to call out was Aaron Schatz, who invented DVOA, tweeted this out today. Brandon Aiyuk had the highest receiving DVOA ever for a wide receiver with at least 100 targets, topping Jerry Rice in his 1989 season, in which Rice had 129 receptions, 1,483 yards, and 17 touchdowns. This season for Brandon Aiyuk, incredibly, incredibly efficient. to the point where it is, again, the best receiving DVOA, which is a value per play, not total value, in mm-hmm. NFL history. So again, kudos to the two wide receivers that the 49ers have for some pretty impressive accomplishments.
Yeah, it's crazy the year Aiyuk had, how efficient he was, and we know what Debo has been doing, and the statistics are all over the place. Purdy sets the 49ers franchise record for highest QB rating in the season. He did 113. Young was previous leader at 112.8. We know that Purdy set the yardage record at 4,208. He just, you know, had one of really just one of the all-time 49er quarterbacking seasons too, which mm-hmm. is incredible. And he's super efficient, and Aiyuk was super efficient. And I saw a McCaffrey stat today too, and I have to pull it back up. I was reading an article by Bill Barnwell on ESPN. And so McCaffrey this season, he has 114 first downs, which is 38 more than any other running back. Just insane.
Wild.
He's turned 33.6% of his touches this season into first downs or touchdowns. So something else maybe we'll get a little bit more into on another show when we look at maybe awards, but he had him actually third for offensive player of the year. He had CeeDee Lamb and Tyreek Hill out of him, which I do not agree with.
I don't either.
And he talked about the MVP, and he had Purdy second, which I think that's where it's going to come in. I think it'll be mm-hmm. Dak third, Purdy second, Lamar first. But he was talking about the year that Purdy had, and it just was like an all-time season. Like mm-hmm. it's going to be an outlier that he doesn't get the MVP with how statistically good Purdy was this year. So Lamar will get it.
Yeah.
And I think the reason Purdy's not going to get it is because of the Christmas game. If that game was at, I don't know, October mm-hmm. at 1 o'clock, and it wasn't a national game, I think it would get swept under the rug.
Yeah.
Because that was Christmas night, and it was a huge game. Everybody watched it. It cost him the MVP. It did. And it's fine.
Lamar's
amazing. But statistically, Purdy had the kind of season that, you know, maybe Dak had a really good statistical season too, so maybe he'll get AP one, All Pro one, but Purdy mm-hmm. should get two at least for that season.
Yeah.
Just really a remarkable season for the 49ers offense statistically and on the field.
Well, and we talked last episode, and Brandon Aiyuk did not get a Pro Bowl nod, but with the type of season that Brandon Aiyuk had, I wouldn't be surprised also if he is AP one or AP two.
Barnwell had him AP two on his predictions. Yeah. He said he's going to have AP two.
Yeah, which would be a huge accomplishment in and of itself. Then the other thing that came out of this, again, Christian McCaffrey didn't play, but he did take home the NFL rushing title, and he became the first 49er to do so since Hall of Famer Perry in 19. Joe the Jet Perry, not to be confused with Benny. Not to be confused with Benny the Jet Rodriguez. But this is Joe the Jet Perry from 1950. I don't know, in the 50s. So it's been quite a while for a 49er to lead the league in rushing. So again, just an all-time season from McCaffrey, Purdy, Aiyuk, Debo, Kittle. It was just an all-time season for a 49ers offense. And it is, I think, this offense that is really going to be the engine that propels them to their sixth Lombardi if they do win it.
Selling a little or a lot? Shopify helps you do your thing, however you cha-ching. Shopify is the global commerce platform that helps you sell at every stage of your business. From the launch your online shop stage, to the first real-life store stage, all the way to the did we just hit a million orders stage. Shopify is here to help you grow. Whether you're selling scented soap or offering outdoor outfits, Shopify helps you sell everywhere. From their all-in-one e-commerce platform to their in-person POS system, wherever and whatever you're selling, Shopify has got you covered. Shopify helps you turn browsers into buyers with the internet's best converting checkout. 15% better on average compared to other leading commerce platforms. And sell more with less effort thanks to Shopify Magic, your AI-powered all-star. Shopify powers 10% of all e-commerce in the U.S. And Shopify is the global force behind Allbirds, Rothy's, and Brooklinen, and millions of other entrepreneurs of every size across 175 countries. Plus, Shopify's award-winning 24/7 help is there to support your success every step of the way. Because businesses that grow, grow with Shopify. Sign up for a $1 per month trial period at shopify.com/odyssey podcast, all lowercase. Go to shopify.com/odyssey podcast now to grow your business, no matter what stage you're in. Shopify.com/odyssey podcast.
The NFL regular season is wrapping up, but there's still time to get in on the action with FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. Right now, new customers get $150 in bonus bets guaranteed when you place a $5 bet. That's $150 in bonus bets, win or lose. The app is so easy to use, and there are so many different ways to bet, like live same-game parlays, find bets in the new Explore tab, make a parlay in the Parlay Hub, the best way to find popular parlays, and more. So visit FanDuel.com/stream and make your first bet a layup. FanDuel, official partner of the NFL. Must be 21 plus and present in select states. FanDuel is offering online sports wagering in Kansas under an agreement with Kansas Star Casino, LLC. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued is non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. Restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER or visit FanDuel.com/RG in Colorado, Iowa, Kentucky, Michigan, New Jersey, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Illinois, Tennessee, and Virginia. Call 1-800-NEXT-STEP or text NEXTSTEP to 53342 in Arizona, 1-888-789-7777, or visit ccpg.org/chat in Connecticut, 1-800-9-WITH-IT in Indiana, 1-800-522-4700, or visit ksgamblinghelp.com in Kansas, 1-877-770-STOP in Louisiana, visit mdgamblinghelp.org in Maryland, visit 1-800-GAMBLER.net in West Virginia, or call 1-800-522-4700 in Wyoming. Hope is here. Visit gamblinghelplinema.org or call 800-327-5050 for 24/7 support in Massachusetts, or call 1-877-8-HOPE-NY or text HOPE-NY in New York.
Diets and workouts, you've done the work, so why can't you get to your goal weight? That's because up to 70% of your weight is predetermined by your genetics. So while you've been told that it's all about your willpower, you're actually fighting your biology. Don't do it alone. Found's Doctor Designed program uses medication as part of a treatment plan that targets your body's unique biological needs so that your body works with you and not against you. Take the quiz at joinfound.com to see if Found's weight loss program is right for you.
Yeah, it's really exciting going into these playoffs, knowing how good the Niners are and knowing that they're really set up. And if you look at, we wanted to look at this playoff field a little bit. Mm-hmm. So you have Dallas. Well, let's break out the games here. I guess we could look at it that way and kind of see where we think this might go. So Cowboys are playing the Packers. Mm-hmm. Packers are a nice upstart story. They look like they were going to be in trouble, and Jordan Love really turned it around. They have a healthy Aaron Jones right now. I love Jaden Reed, the rookie receiver that they have. They have some really good in Wicks. Forget his first name, but he's really solid. Is that it? Okay. Mm-hmm. Really solid. Their defense, but some exciting stuff going on.
Yeah.
With that, the Lions and the Rams.
That's a great matchup game. Great matchup
game.
All-time revenge game.
crazy to have the Matthew Stafford storyline and the Jared Goff storyline. Mm-hmm. I mean, NFL, it's amazing that this stuff keeps happening with the NFL over and over and over again. The stuff keeps happening. And look, I tweeted about it last night in the AFC. It's not how you start, how you finish, because the Bills were 6-6 at Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. They end up with the 2 seed, as shitty as they've been playing. They ended up with the 2 seed. And the Jags were 8-3, and they're out of the playoffs.
Yeah.
So it's all about how you finish. And a team that kind of scares me right now is the Rams. I do not want to play the Rams. I don't.
Yeah.
And the Lions Lions are favored by 3.5 there. The Cowboys are favored by 7.5. I forgot to say that in the other game. And then the Monday night game, which is a game of two teams just going in the complete wrong direction. What the hell happened to the Eagles? Holy shit.
You know what happened to the Eagles? The San Francisco 49ers happened to the Eagles.
Well, I don't think the Niners and the Jaguars. I think they were breaking and the Niners just gave it a little nudge and they shattered. I think that they were a shattered team when they were coming in, or just about to shatter. And the Niners just kind of pushed them over the edge. I mean, everything is going wrong. AJ Brown hurts his knee. I don't know how badly he's hurt. I haven't seen that. Jalen Hurts hurt his hand. He hasn't looked the same, and they're playing a Bucks team where Baker Mayfield doesn't look healthy either with his shoulder. And they got destroyed by the Saints last week. They went 9-0 against an awful Panthers team. Mm-hmm. So that Monday night game could be a stinker. But that could also be the team the Niners are playing. So I'm going to ask you.
That's my hope.
Let's just do this now because
might
as well. Dallas, Green Bay, who do you got there?
I think that game, I'm going to go with Dallas because as good as the Packers offense has been, I just don't think that Packers defense can stop the Cowboys offense. That Yeah. They can't even stop a nosebleed. So, you know, I think one little interesting wrinkle, I think the Packers end up losing that game. And I think after that game, they will dismiss their defensive coordinator. I think an interesting hire could be Wink Martindale, who just resigned from the New York Giants. I think that'd be a huge get for them, and would make them better instantly. Yeah, they do all hate Brian Daboll.
I'm pretty sure his entire coaching staff hates Brian Daboll. I didn't realize he was so difficult, Brian Daboll.
Neither did I, yeah.
Because coming out of Buffalo, I never heard any of that stuff about him.
Yeah.
If it was there, I didn't hear it. But, yeah.
But he does come from that, you know, I think he kind of comes from that Nick Saban kind of tree a little bit.
Yeah.
And I think that's part of it.
Rubs people the wrong way.
Yeah.
Such a good game. I can't wait for this game. Rams and Lions.
This one's so hard. I think the Rams, I think the Rams could, you could argue they should be favored. But I don't know about that Rams defense. The Rams offense is great. It's just when, you know, with Stafford healthy and Nacua and Kupp and Sean McVay pulling the strings and Kyron Williams running the ball, it's a great offense. Their defense is nothing special though. And I just think that even if the Lions can't expose that defense, if they beat the Lions, then that's who the 49ers will play, unless the Packers beat the Cowboys.
Which is unlikely, yeah.
Which is unlikely. Not impossible, but unlikely. And funny. That would be hysterical, by the way. If the Cowboys lose in the first round as the 2 seed. I would just laugh uncontrollably. But I think that game is going to be a high scoring shootout. And, you know, I mean, the Lions held their own defensively against the Cowboys in that game 2 weeks ago. So I'm not saying that they can't, but I don't know. I think the Rams will end up winning that game, which means that I do think that the 49ers will end up playing the Rams in the divisional round. I'm not worried about it though. Their defense is what I think is going to hold them back from advancing too far in the playoffs. And, you know, with a full complement of offensive players, I think Kyle Shanahan will beat Sean McVay every time.
Yeah. That game would worry me because again, the division thing, you never know. Again, I just feel, I know the Rams just won. That game wasn't a real game.
No,
I just feel law of averages at some point. I just, you know me, I worry, but I think the Lions are going to win. The Laporta injury is huge.
It
huge
is
for them, but I still think that because there's no way Laporta's playing next week based on
no, they should bring Zach Ertz in is what they should do.
Yes. Yeah. Well, for as much as he can get caught up in a week, but yeah, they should. Right. Like just kind of bring him into, even if it's 10 plays, he can help you or whatever, bring him in and do that. Yeah. But I just think the Rams or the Lions have the two running backs. They're home. You know, Ben Johnson, I think Ben Johnson can outscore John McVay in this game. That's how I think it would
I think so too.
So yeah. I would go the Lions there if it were me. So, which means if I'm right, the winner of this next game would be who the 49ers would play. And please God, let that happen because I would
let it be the Eagles.
Either have the Eagles or the Bucs. Yeah. And I think here, as bad as the Eagles are playing, and it looks like to me, like if they were playing anybody else, any of these teams, I would say they're going to lose.
Yeah,
but I just feel like the Bucs suck too. I just feel like the Eagles are more talented than the Bucs. I cannot buy Baker Mayfield. I can't. Mm-hmm. Maybe he'll prove me wrong, but I'm going to say the Eagles win an ugly one, and it'll kind of be chalk, I guess, going into the next round for the NFC. As far as I think,
that's not quite chalk because the Eagles.
Oh no, you're right. Sorry. Yeah.
But close.
Not chalk. Yeah, close to chalk. So.
That is my ideal scenario is Cowboys and Lions win and then the Eagles beat the Bucks because I desperately want to put the final nail in the coffin of these Eagles in Santa Clara in the divisional round. Not only that, but if the Cowboys and Lions win, then the 49ers will play whoever wins that Bucks Eagles game, which means that the 49ers playoff game would be on Sunday because that Eagles Bucks game is on Monday. So that bodes well for me as a watcher of the game. to have that on Sunday instead of Saturday, because Saturday will still be in Vegas instead of traveling home from Vegas.
Yeah, and I don't know, man. That's kind of the way I feel like it's going to go. And then that Cowboys Lions game, it's a coin flip. We've already seen a game played by them that was a coin flip. I think it's the same thing if that's the way it goes. And I think the Niners would destroy again. I think they would love to see the Eagles and just say, okay, we beat you in the regular season. We're going to beat you in the playoffs too. I think the Niners would be so up for that game. It would be great. And then the NFL's dream would be Cowboys Niners in that NFC Championship game.
Oh yeah,
I mean, for sure. The ratings for sure. That game would do. NFL's dream to have.
Yeah, that. Yeah, yeah. And I don't know that there is a matchup in these playoffs on either side that would draw as big as Cowboys Niners in a championship game, conference championship game.
Whew. Would be an amazing game.
Fire.
Yeah, it would be NFL's dream for that to happen. And I think that's the way it's going. I kind of think those two teams are on a collision course. You can get a team, you know, again, the Rams could be feisty. You never know. But Lions can surprise people here and maybe get the NFC Championship. I don't know, that would be a huge upset, but I feel like they're a solid third. Everybody thinks the Niners and the Cowboys are the top two. But I feel like that's the way that it's going to go. And it's an upset for me. Do I want to say disappointment? Maybe. Probably. Yeah, it is a disappointment if the 49ers don't make the Super Bowl. It's laid out for them.
Yeah.
I know Dallas can score, and I know they're a really good team, but the Niners have obliterated them earlier in the season. They beat them twice in the playoffs. And again, law of averages, I get it. You know, that stuff's always there, but we've seen Dak against this defense. You know, Dak looks great against Washington. And then he plays the Niners D, and he seems to look shell-shocked every time he's played him.
Look how he played against Buffalo.
Yeah. Yeah. It's for me, Dak, and Dak had an amazing season. He had a great year. Great year. He had a few duds in there, but overall he had a terrific season. Until I see him in the playoffs. And I know he had the game against the Bucs, but I need to see him put a string of games together in the playoffs for me to buy it. And until he does that, I just can't. So it's going to be really tough for me to pick anybody against the 49ers right now. I think they're the best team in the NFC. They should be healthy, hopefully. You have 3 weeks off, basically, going in there. If they can get through, the only thing I worry about, I know we talked about Moody, but the rust. Can they get through that rust? Because there's going to be. Yeah. The first quarter might be ugly, the January 20th, 21st, whatever it is. Could be a little bit like, okay, we're working through things. Once they get through that, I think it's all systems go. And I think the team's on a mission. So,
yeah. And, you know, again, if it goes the way that we anticipate, either one of those teams are ripe for, you know, a get right game, if you will, or a knock the rust off game, because I don't think the Bucks or the Eagles are anywhere near the caliber of the 49ers. The Bucks definitely aren't, and the Eagles, the way they've been playing, are not. Talent wise, sure, but I mean, who knew that the secret sauce to this Eagles team was Big Dom? Like, who knew? Like, but here we are. Here we are. The Eagles are 1-5 since Big Dom got kicked off the sidelines. So.
And also,
Matt, get that money, man. Get that money.
Matt Patricia. I mean, everything he's around goes to shit, it feels like, too. So,
yeah,
whatever they did with him, I don't know if he's in charge of their defense or just elevated him or whatever.
The play caller.
Is he the play caller now?
He's not. Defensive play caller. Yeah.
Yeah. Defense looks terrible right now. So,
yeah.
You got to love to see it, though. you got to love to see it.
Like I said, I mean, my ideal scenario again is just nailing that final nail in the coffin of that Eagle season in Santa Clara in the divisional round. Just chef's kiss. Perfect for me.
Yeah.
With BlueLink Plus, you can access your Hyundai Tucson Limited remotely. Doors unlocked, temperature set, lost car found. Get complimentary class-leading Blue Link Plus. Call 562-314-4603 for complete details.
Let's do AFC real quick. I just want to hear what you think. Because why not?
Yeah.
Hold on.
I can't believe the Bills are the two seed. I just can't believe it.
The Eagles are favored by 2.5, by the way. I always want to give the spreads when I see this.
Yeah.
I forget. So let's start with my Gumar, the Buffalo Bills. love the Bills. Was up watching. My wife is a Buffalo girl, so we were up watching that game last night.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Yeah. So listen, man. Josh Allen, most chaos talented agent. Dude in the world. Oh, my God. Nobody makes more careless throws than Josh Allen.
Yeah.
And then you'll talk to him after the game, and he's like, yeah, I got to stop doing that. And he goes up the next game and he does it. And
McDermott but I won't.
Under the bus. Did you? Yeah, he's never going to. Yeah. Did you see what McDermott said at halftime when he's like taking whatever he said? Basically, he didn't so much throw Allen under the bus, but he was being way too aggressive in the red zone and kind of like, basically, my quarterback's got to be smarter. Yeah. And Allen handled it perfectly. At the end of the game, he just put it all to bed. He was like, yeah, I'm right. He's right. I got to be.
Yeah.
Over. You know what I mean? Over. Distraction over. But listen, I get it. As talented as Allen is, that offense has not looked right. And the Bills have pulled a lot of games out of their ass in this five-game winning streak. They should barely beat a Chargers team that has all backups. They barely beat a bad Patriots team. It seems like they keep trying to lose, but they're not. And they're going to open up as the 2 seed against number 7 Steelers without TJ Watt. Bills are That's up 9.5 favorite, which is a lot.
That's too much. That's too much for this Bills team. Yeah.
Way too much. But I think they're going to pull it out at home. That place is going to be crazy. And I think the Bills are going to win that game.
Yeah, I think they'll win the game, especially with TJ Watt out. That's a real bummer for the Steelers. But also, I'm really digging the Mason Rudolph redemption story. Like,
are you kidding me?
That's pretty awesome.
And how bad are Mitch Trubisky and Kenny Pickett that Mason Rudolph is coming in?
Real bad. Real bad.
I mean, Kenny Pickett's got a future backup.
Yeah, I feel like there's no way you could go back to him after this season. But I don't think the Steelers have enough on offense. I think their defense will keep them in the game, maybe even through the first three quarters. I think Josh Allen is going to be more than willing to throw them the ball a couple times. That's just kind of been his game this season, which is why I always thought that there was really no way that you could give him the MVP just with the amount of turnovers that he has. It's just
way too many.
He's just too careless with the football. And part of it is just, if I was as physically gifted as Josh Allen, I'd be careless with the football as well, because I would believe every single time I drop back that no matter what the throw is, I can make it. And I think that's part of the problem for him. And I think as he ages and that starts to diminish, I hope that he can understand a little bit more, like, hey, I gotta be better. And, you know, there's one thing to say it after the game, after you have these boneheaded, interceptions. But it's another to put that on the field. And so it'll be interesting to see, what it looks like, again, especially with TJ Watt out. But the Steelers defense is good. They're a solid unit, and they will put pressure on that Buffalo team. But this Buffalo team plays down to the level of their competition every single week. And so a 9.5-point spread, I think, is absolutely ridiculous, because there's no way that they're blowing a team out. They're just not right now. They'll win this game, but I don't see them winning it by more than a touchdown.
Yeah. And I put money at Pittsburgh. I got it plus 10.
There you go.
The 3 seed are the Kansas City Chiefs.
Yeah.
And they are going to play your squad.
That's right.
But an absolute beat up Dolphins team. I heard Jalen Waddle is going to be back. I assume Mostert's going to be, but they've lost both. They've lost Jalen Phillips. They've lost Bradley Chubb. They lost another one of their pass rushers last night.
Andrew Van Ginkel.
Really beat up, and they can't beat a good team anyway. They should have lost to the Cowboys. Other than that, any good team they play, they lose to. Still, really entertaining game that's on Peacock, which is ridiculous.
Stupid.
Give me a break, NFL. We signed up for it because the Bills were on, what was it, like the Saturday
before
or whatever it was.
Yeah.
So whatever, we're like for $3 or whatever it is, we'll sign up for it.
You still have it, yeah.
So I'll be able to do that. They used to be able to do the free trials, but I couldn't do that. So I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know why. But anyway. This is tough for me. I really want to see the Dolphins win this game. I really want to see the Dolphins win this game. But based on what we have seen, as much as the Chiefs look like they're struggling, I feel like the Chiefs will find a way to pull this out of Arrowhead.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, the issue is it's in Kansas City. And the other issue is that this Dolphins team really hasn't proven that they can beat a good opponent. And it hurts my heart because I love Mike McDaniel. I believe in Mike McDaniel. I think part of their issue is the quarterback position. And, you know, it's really interesting to me that Mike McDaniel just has to look in LA at Sean McVay and what he did in getting rid of Jared Goff and bringing in Matthew Stafford. I think Mike McDaniel has his Matthew Stafford waiting for him out there, and his name is Kirk Cousins. I think Kirk Cousins would be incredible in that offense, and I think that that team would be scary with Kirk back there. So I'm interested to see kind of what that looks like in the offseason.
You think they're not going to re-sign Tua and maybe Kirk?
I mean,
that's interesting.
I think it depends on how things go in these playoffs. And
true.
Here's the thing. It's not only is it in Kansas City, but now it's Mike McDaniel going against playoff Steve Spagnuolo, who is one of the better matchup defensive coordinators in the NFL. That Kansas City defense has been good all year. It's the Kansas City offense that hasn't been terribly great. The advantage for Miami is that they're beat up on defense, but again, it's not a high powered Kansas City Chiefs offense. But at a certain point, they have nobody to rush the passer. They have Melvin Ingram, who was sitting on the couch at Thanksgiving and, you know, was brought in to be a situational pass rusher, thinking, hey, I'll get in 10, 15 plays a game. And now he's going to be a starter because every single edge player is hurt, including now Andrew Van Ginkle with some kind of foot injury. And then another guy who got hurt on a kickoff was one of their edge rushers, and he was carted off towards the end of that game. And so I just think there's too many injuries on that defensive side to overcome, even with Vic Fangio as a wonderful defensive coordinator. At a certain point, it's just the law of diminishing returns. And so, you know, I could see them winning that game, but if I'm being perfectly honest, if you play that game 10 times, I think the Chiefs probably win at 9. So there's that 10% chance that the Dolphins could pull this out. And if they do, that would be incredible. But then they got to go play the Ravens. So unless the Steelers beat the Bills.
And they
just got their ass handed to them by the Ravens. So,
but I think, I think Kansas City pulls it out. They're a 3.5-point favorite. And then you have Kansas City going to Buffalo, right? Next round, which would be just awesome. Last game is the Browns at the Texans. Browns are 2.5-point favorites. Browns defense is awesome at home, not the same on the road. Joe Flacco, you know, he's going to probably throw a couple to the other team, but he's also been an incredible story with the yards and the way this team has looked. I really like the Browns. Really like the Browns. And the Texans, look, the Colts aren't a good team. Texans barely got out of that game. Tank Dell is hurt. He's not there. They needed an amazing game from Nico Collins to win that game.
And they got one.
Yeah, and a drop pass on fourth down. So I don't, you know, Stroud, he's a rookie. I really like Cleveland here. I think Cleveland's going to go on the road and take this.
But shout out to D'Amico Ryans, first-year head coach, guiding the Texans not only to the playoffs, but a division title.
Yeah.
Right on. Right on. I love it. I love that for D'Amico. I love that. Bobby Slowick. Jimmy Ward is on that team, right? So Niner love there. Here's what I want though. If we're going chalk, but the Browns beat the Texans, so it's the same situation that we think happens in the NFC. The five seed beats the 4 seed. That's a Browns Ravens matchup. That's a tough matchup for the Ravens.
Oh, yeah.
That's a tough matchup for the Ravens. And I love that for them.
That would be an awesome game.
Yeah.
Like defensive, just knocking the shit out of each other. Yeah. Don't sleep. If Joe Flacco can play the way that he did the last 4 weeks or whatever it's been, do not sleep on the Browns.
And then if Joe Flacco goes in and knocks the Ravens out of the playoffs, could you imagine? God.
Oh, I didn't even think about that either. It was even in my head.
Woo! That would be incredible.
And that's just the way it's been happening this year. Like Stafford goes against the Lions, Goff goes against the Rams. You're gonna have Flacco going against the Ravens. It's why the NFL is just the best. The shit just always happens. The football gods set it up. But I think that's gonna be a really tough game. And Lamar, you know, we talked about it with Jason Lockenfora. The Ravens have a lot of hills to get over on their own. They, mm-hmm. Lamar's got to, you know, Harbaugh hasn't won a playoff game in a while. Has he? It's been a while. Lamar struggled in the playoffs. So they have to get over that hump too. I think they do. And I think just because it doesn't make any sense because they're playing so shitty, I think the Bills somehow end up in the AFC Championship. And I think you're going to see Bills Ravens. I think they get that close. Ravens are just, again, I feel like the Niners and Ravens are just on this collision course. And I feel like it's going to happen this year. So I don't think they'll get past the Ravens. I think it'd be the Niners and the Ravens in the Super Bowl.
I think so too. But I will say this. If the Browns do come away with a victory against Houston and then go into Baltimore and beat Baltimore, I think the Bills are the AFC representative. And a Chris Berman Super Bowl, 49ers Bills, used to predict it every damn year. Would be phenomenal. That would be phenomenal. And that I will say this right now. I would much rather face the Bills than the Ravens. Hands down.
Hands down. Agree. Yeah. Sacco House is going to get ugly if that's the case. Oh,
yeah. Yeah.
Can't do it. The wife's going to have all the Bills stuff on. It's going to be rough.
A house divided.
Go watch the game somewhere else, I think. So, yeah. If you watch,
I love the Bills too. I love the Bills. I love their color scheme. I love their old school logo. I love Josh Allen. Like, I have a soft spot for the Bills. Unfortunately, again, they're in the same division as the Dolphins, who are my current, my AFC mistress, if you will.
Yeah, if you watch our clips, you know, I don't know if you ever look behind me, but I got a lot of memorabilia and stuff down in my basement at my bar where I do this, and I got the Niner stuff behind me. If you look over my right shoulder, there may or may not be a Buffalo Bills thing right there. So, not saying I put it up.
I don't think it's not in view.
It's not in view. No, that's what I mean. Like, if you're right over here on my right,
there
may or may not be a big Buffalo Bills thing on the wall. So, nice.
I like it.
What are you going to do? Hey. You know, the wife.
It's the local team. It's the wife. It's an AFC team. At least it's an AFC team.
Yeah. Right? It's out of the, don't have to worry about it. Usually once every 4 years, but this year,
they do play each other next year.
I'm going to,
the 49ers play the AFC East. So
pull some credentials for that game. I did the last time they were in Buffalo. I did get credentialed for it.
It's in Buffalo, right? Yeah.
Yeah. That was the first game I ever covered, like in the press box.
Very cool.
Really cool. And the Niners got destroyed that game. That was a game Kaepernick came back his first start, I think. It was after the kneeling and everything. And so it was like, it was crazy. Like, it was like with the press and everything with that game, like, what's going to happen? And the Niners started out okay, and then they got their doors blown off. It was like 41-15 or something ridiculous. It was pretty bad. So,
if you get credentialed, we will do the post game, and you will do it from Orchard Park.
I don't think I can. I don't know if I could do that, because you got to, the way it is, like, usually after the game, you leave the press box and then you go down to the locker room. I'd have to figure it out. I don't know.
Grant does his post games from Levi's every home
game. Oh, does he really?
Yeah.
I've covered only a handful of games. I always thought I had to leave. So I don't know. Maybe the guys who actually like work for, you know, are there every week.
Privileges.
I don't know. I felt weird being there anyway. So it's kind of like,
we'll figure it out.
But
I love it.
Whatever. All right.
Thursday. What do we got coming up Thursday, Al?
Thursday. That's what I was going to say. Yeah. So we got an old friend. We mentioned an old friend. I reached out to my buddy, Keanu Martin, who was a 49ers senior reporter for years. And she worked for teams since 2017. And I was like, that'd be great if the fans kind of can hear from you and see what you think about the past 2 years. So she said, yeah, she's all in. She's going to come on Thursday, and we're going to talk to her about what she's been up to and what she thinks of the Niners and all that stuff. So that'll be fun to talk to Kiana again and get everybody reacquainted with her.
Absolutely. And then, hey, 49ers, going to sit at home and watch everybody else beat each other up. And we will see who the 49ers get to face in the divisional round. And we will make sure to preview that game. But until then, for Al, I'm Brian. Later.
9-0-3! 1-2-3!
Ah! 2400 Sports is an Odyssey company.